Here is an alternate version of the program. Now there are complicated three cases, but here also I am using the if-else ladder, but in a different way. How is the ladder being used now? I am first starting with the lowest stage. So I first examine if age is less than 12. And if it is yes, I do something. If it is no, this is where I will, I will check another condition. Again, yes, no. So I am constructing a ladder, but with reversal of the rule. You can verify by hand execution of these statements whether things work correctly or not. What is the hand execution? I'll remind you again. Given any program, you can of course make the C++ Dumbo do the Godagiri and run the program. But to verify whether you have written the program correctly or not, you should give some sample input and behave as if you are C++. Execute the program, write down the values that different objects will have and confirm whether program works correctly. And you have to do it with two or three alternate inputs to cross verify. You can indeed check that it works correctly. Here is a question. Could I have exchanged these two conditions in the first two parts of the ladder? Could I have said if age less than 60, ticket cost is 25.50, else if age less than 60, no. Because why not? You see, some people have figured it out mentally, but this is something I would suggest all of you should do. Try to exchange these conditions and try to execute the algorithm with two or three sample values. Typical sample values is age given is 5 years, age given is say 24 years, age given is 63 years. These are the three partitions in which the logic is divided. And you can check whether in each case you get the correct value of ticket or not. If you do, your logic is correct. As I said, you can implement the logic in multiplicity of ways. To come back to our friend's question, okay, these are the two versions. I have just put them side by side to indicate just two different ways of writing the same algorithm. I will be putting up these slides on the Moodle by tonight so you can look at them, but I think you get the point. Here is another question. Given two numbers, find out the maximum of two numbers. Let's say A and B are two numbers. First, I read them to find out the maximum. Now, typically, the maximum is found out by a comparison. Is A greater than B? The answer is yes or no. On the yes side, I will say something called max equal to A. If the answer is no, I will say something called max equal to B. And in either case, I will come out here first of all, do you agree that this flowchart will work correctly and in location? No, it will not. Why? Suppose I give two values as input. First value is 5, second value is also 5. Which is the maximum amongst these two? 5. Is it the first 5 or the second 5? It's a meaningless question. So if the two numbers are same, it doesn't matter which of them gets assigned to max. It will still be the correct mathematical maximum of the two. So max, that is a different question. The problem is not that. Given two integer numbers A and B, find the maximum of these. No, then there is something else. So he is saying, suppose I want to find out which one of them is maximum. And this question is not trivial, by the way. Sooner or later, rather than sooner, when we discuss arrays, we will come across this particular issue. To give you an example, suppose I have these 500 students and the mid-sem marks are recorded against the roll numbers. So roll numbers are stored, corresponding marks are stored. And I want to know who has scored the maximum. But I would also like to know who scored that maximum. So I would like to know where exactly in my collection of values this maximum. So the point that he makes is correct. However, right now the problem we are solving is just finding out the maximum value. So that's all. You had a question somewhere here? No. So, here is a program to solve that problem. Int a comma b comma max. Input a comma b. Sorry, input C in greater greater A, greater greater B. Now my favorite if statement, if A greater than B, max is equal to A, else max is equal to B. Output max. Solve the problem. Alternate logic. You remember I did something fancy while illustrating the possible way of calculating the bus ticket when there were only two conditions. I can do something similar here. I can say input A and B, then I can say max is equal to A arbitrarily. I don't know who is the maximum. Now I will check, is A greater than B? On the yes side, I have to do nothing. On the no side, I have to do what? But here is an additional squiggle. Why should I say A greater than B? After all, currently I have assumed A is maximum. So the max contains the maximum value. Why not compare max with the next number? This logic will tell me that I will say max is equal to A. Then I will check, is B greater than max? If yes, I will say max is equal to B, otherwise I will simply get out. Both are correct, they will work correctly. However, this second alternative logic is better suited for extending this logic later, as we shall see when we study iteration. I can use a very simple program like this to find out maximum of 200 numbers. 5,000 numbers, 20 numbers, okay. Here are the two versions. Just to illustrate, everybody got this? Version 1, version 2, very straightforward. If I were to extend the logic of version 1 to find out maximum of say 3 numbers, and if I were to extend the logic of version 2 to find out the maximum of 3 numbers, I get completely different algorithms. In the first case, I will get a slightly complicated algorithm. I have now 3 numbers. I have input values of A, B, and C. Now I will check as usual, is A greater than B? Yes. Am I clear whether max is A? Not yet. I have to now check the third fellow, C. So I'll have to check, is A greater than C? If yes, now I know A is the big box. So I'll say max is A. Otherwise, what I have to say? Max is C. On the other hand, if A is not greater than B, can I simply say B is max? No. Now I have to compare B and C. If B is greater than C, I now know max is equal to B. Otherwise, Wow, so many arrows. But I hope you appreciate that this logic will work correctly. Just imagine, now if I say, given four numbers A, B, C and D, find out which is the max. If you have to implement this logic, what will you say? Input A, B, C, all right. If A greater than B, then if A greater than C, max equal to this, else maximum, else, if B greater than C, etc. This is that logic. Notice that I am inputting the three numbers A, B and C. If A greater than B, the next statement is not a normal statement, it's another brass, opening brass. Inside, if B greater than C, now max is equal to A. Else, if A greater than C, max is equal to A, else max is equal to C. Else, if B greater than C, max is equal to B, else max is equal to C. Is this correct? Not correct. This is not certainly the logic that we had shown in the previous graph. Here I had, is A greater than C? Yes, this, else this. So there is, this is not what it does. This program will be on the Moodle. Just check, what does this logic do? Find out whether I am unnecessarily and excessively checking some condition. Find out whether in the other case, I am checking the condition correctly or not, and check what the result is. The point to be made here is the following fact. If I have to implement this logic, I will have to write what is called nested ifs, if within if. If I have to find out the maximum of four values, the nested if will increase one more level. And we will all go mad if somebody says find out the maximum of 10 numbers. Then we will be writing down for half an hour and matching brackets and so on. Meanwhile, another friend of his, a high school student, not even an IIT student, would have said, give me those 10 numbers. He would have written them by hand on the paper and said, ah, this is the maximum. And then he will laugh at all of us. The alternate logic is what I told you earlier. Input is all right. Now I start by saying max is equal to A. I check. What do I check now? Is B greater than max? If yes, what will happen? Max is equal to B. Otherwise nothing. I come out here, I check. Is C greater than max? If true, what will happen? So what I am doing is, I have converted the whole logic into a problem of writing a series of simple ifs. I start with the assumption that the first number is maximum. I check whether second number is greater than that. If so, I replace the current value of maximum. I check the third number. At any point in time, if a number is smaller than any one of the earlier numbers, max will not be replaced by the new value. Do you see the intrinsic simplicity and the possible power of the second version? Indeed, whenever you think of finding out maximum of three numbers, you should automatically think of the second logic, because that logic is extendable. Consider this problem. Find maximum of five numbers. Those of you who are very courageous can go home and try to write this in that complicated logic. If A less than greater than B, then if A is greater than C, then if A is greater than D, then if A is greater than E, then max is E. Else something, else something, else something, and madness. That's why I said those of you who are very courageous can try that. I am a very tame fellow, I like this. and it works. You agree that it works? It has also another great advantage of a possible generalization. Later on, when we discuss arrays, where A, B, C, D, E will not be different names, but different indices indicating array elements, we will find that we can iteratively execute the algorithm to find out the maximum of thousands of numbers. So is this clear? This is the power of it. A comparison will always ensure that a condition is evaluated and it evaluates to true or false. There is a special type in C++ called Boolean. It's called bool actually. You remember the word bool I had used while showing various types? That's this type. Technically, the value is true or false. Practically, C++ implements these values as a numerical value. Why have an unnecessary jhamela when I have only two possible values? I actually require one bit to represent that value. Since my smallest storage allocation is 1 byte, I might keep a true value or a false value somewhere in 1 byte location. But by convention, C++ says that a false value will be always stored as a numerical 0, true value will always be stored as a numerical 1. Not necessarily stored, but converted into 0 or 1 in case you wish to use the computational result of a condition evaluation in any arithmetic operation. It is possible to do so. It is possible to multiply m by a condition written in brackets n greater than 5. If n is greater than 5, the result of m multiplied by n greater than 5 will be m, because n greater than 5 will evaluate to 1, otherwise it will evaluate to 0. We will not complicate our life by looking into what happens when condition is treated as a numerical value, but we just record for our understanding that internally conditions are actually equivalent to numerical. Technically, they are true or false. Now, the complication which my friend suggested. Can I not test conditions such as age greater than 12 and age less than 60? This requires combining two conditions. Compound conditions are permitted. And the compound conditions are implemented using the Boolean operators AND, OR, and NOT. You are familiar with AND, OR, NOT? Fine. Exactly the same logic is done. However, the AND operator is twice ampersand, AND. The OR operator is vertical bar twice. Negation is a exclamation mark. It is also interesting to see the basic comparison operators. Greater than, less than, etc., you will all understand. But you notice that there is nothing like equal to anywhere here. Why? Equal to symbol is used by C++ to indicate assignment operation. It cannot simultaneously indicate a comparison operation. So if you want to say, is age equal to 13, you have to say, if age equal 13. It's an interesting thing to see what happens. Versus if you write, the second statement is wrong. Unfortunately, it is not wrong. Oh, oops, sorry. 2 equal to. The first one is a valid condition. It compares whether age is equal to 13 or not. The second one is a valid assignment operation. What will do that operation? You might have written it in bracket where a condition should have been written, but as far as C++ is concerned, it's an assignment operation. It will assign the value 13 to age, independent of what you have given as input. And the value of this expression, as we have seen, is what? 13. Now there is a problem. Is 13 true or false? In terms of interpreting numerical values as Boolean values, the other way around. If a Boolean value is converted to 0 or 1, to represent false or true. But if a numerical value is by chance happens to be examined as a Boolean value, it will treat any non-zero value as true, zero as false. So this will be true. Anyway, these are side effects. As far as we are concerned, we neglect all of this. This is exactly how we will write operators inside a condition. Wherever a condition is written, we should always use equal to make equality comparison. Rest of it is straightforward. Understood? There are examples of these conditions. I will not go through those, but there are handouts which will be distributed. So while we discuss the last statement of this course, I will distribute these handouts. There are 7 problems in the handout. Some of them involve the older issues that we have discussed, floating point representation, etc. And some of them involve what we have discussed today. Please try to solve these problems at home. Some of these problems will appear in the lab that you will do next week. And you will have to, in the lab, of course, we don't expect you to write 50-line programs as an assignment. So we will probably give you pre-written programs for solving the problems. You can actually compare those with whatever you have written. And we'll ask you to modify those programs to do something more. That will be the essence of the lab from next week onwards. The switch statement is the last statement I wish to discuss. This is a very special form of if and is written in a completely different syntax. You have seen a menu anytime? Have you gone to a hotel? So in the hotel, that fellow says, this is my menu. On the left hand side, items are listed, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You actually name the item when you order, but you can also say, get me item number 4, get me item number 5. Menu is nothing but a list of choices. And you have to make a choice from given choices. In computer applications, it is not uncommon to find a screen in front of you when you go to an application. For example, banking application. So you have a bank account. You log into that banking system and you say number 1, transfer money. Number 2, withdraw cash. Number 3, apply for a loan. Number 4, apply for a checkbook. So when you type 1, suddenly the program will go to that function which will execute the operations for 1. In such cases, you are taking an input, a single value, which is a choice 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If the choice is 1, you have to do that and get out. If the choice is 2, you have to do that and get out. If the choice is 3, you have to do something else and get out. So you require an if. But you don't require to complicate your life with nested ifs and all. Your choices are rather simple. In such cases, you may want a very special kind of if, which is a branch. So you need some kind of an if which has, let's say, and here you don't want a single answer yes or no. You are actually examining the value of f. If it is equal to 1, then you want to do something and get out. If it is equal to 2, you want to do something and get out. Understand? 1, do this, get out. 2, do this, get out. 3, do this, get out. Suppose you have given in your menu only 7 choices. And now I type 8. 8, there is no action that you have written. So there is something called default, meaning none of these, you come here and get. In each of these branches, you can specify actions. So this is a very special kind of if. You can imagine this conditional box, which is not a conventional condition because I am not writing a condition there. You can interpret this conditional box to be like a switch, a multipolar switch. Depending on the value, you put the switch in direction of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1 means you will go there, 2 means you will go there, 3 means you will go there. It is like a routing algorithm. There are 5 roads going out, Somebody comes in saying, where should I go? I say, what is your value? 3. You go to 3. 2, you go here. Get the point? If I want to implement this, there is a logic available, and this is the switch statement which is available in C++. So this statement is written with a keyword switch. Inside the condition, you write an expression, not a condition. Sorry, inside the brackets, you don't write a condition, you write an expression. The value of that expression is evaluated. For example, if I want to examine the value of m, I can just write m. M is an expression, standalone. Based on the values, I can write a series of cases. Case constant 1. That constant 1 means the value for which I want to execute that part. So here I will write an example. What I have written is a funny program. That funny program says that if the value of m is 1, n should be 2. If the value of m is 2, n should be minus 2. And if there is any other value of m, n should be 0. I don't know why anybody would like to implement such an idiotic logic, but suppose there is a program, there is a problem like this, this is how it can be implemented very easily. It doesn't make sense if you have just one or two simple rules and simple values. But it does make sense when you have to do something like 10 actions here, 20 actions here, 5 actions here, 7 actions there. Then this becomes an extremely easy way of tabulating. First option this, second option this, third option this, fourth one. There are variations in this switch statement which you can very easily see. So we will end the normal lecture here, but I still need 5 minutes from you. Has everybody got a copy of the, you stopped distributing, is it? No, you should never stop. Okay, so while these are being distributed, let me discuss a few things which are important. We have got a big confusion because on the Moodle, the Moodle still shows about 120 extra students in this course. I am going to take it up with the head of the metallurgy department to clean up the mess. But it is our desire that from next week when you go to the labs, there would be specific TAs allocated to a specific group of students. Okay. Second, please. Good question. This question I will reiterate. The modulo operator which gives remainder, does it work only for positive values? I will ask one more question. Does it work for floating point values? Have you checked it? No. When I said, does it work for floating point values, he immediately said no. When I asked him, have you checked it, he says no. But he firmly believes, and rightly so, that modulo operator has no meaning in the context of fractional numbers. The modulo operator is defined for integers. Whether it works for negative numbers or not. So let me ask the general opinion. What do you feel? Should it work or should it not work? The modulo operation as defined in arithmetic, is it defined only for positive integers? Yes, somebody is saying yes, somebody is saying no. whatever is the definition, does C++ honor it? What does it implement? The correct answer at this stage is you don't know, as he does not. And the correct place to find out is to experiment and find out. Correct. No. You are talking of a different thing. Okay. He is saying that he gave a negative value for that 31st December question and he got something else. He is therefore concluding that the modulo operator does not work. That is incorrect conclusion. The conclusion is incorrect because that program is doing variety of other things. The correct way to test whether modulo operation works correctly on negative numbers or not is to write a simple three-line program. Int m, input m, C out m modulo 3, whatever. And now give different values to m and find out what happened. That and only that will confirm how C++. I like this point because it gave me an opportunity to elaborate that, once again I repeat what I said earlier, normally in all your educational life, you are used to either reading and understanding from the book or somebody explaining it to you what this means. And you are also used to, whenever you have doubts, to ask someone and get the doubts clarified. By all means, continue to do that. That's a good practice. But I am saying, now that you come to IIT, now you come to engineering education, you must also learn an additional dimension of learning. Experimenting. So whenever you have doubt, you experiment, but let that experiment be focused. Our friend did experiment. He did give a negative number in response to running a program, but he wrongly concluded that there is a problem with model. His conclusion may be right, but it is based on wrong experiment. The experiment must be, I do exactly what I have doubt about and see what C++ does. In addition, I must also read more about that particular operation in C++ standards, which are available on the net. So I don't know whether you have tried to say C++ tutorial on internet. You will get an extremely good cpp.com site, which gives the complete tutorial. It has a 131-page PDF document. Unfortunately, they have not open sourced it. It says you can make a copy for your own reference, but you can't distribute. Many of us who do not have easy access to internet, therefore, are denied access to that model. That is why our effort is to create our own notes, keep them in open source and distribute. But those of you who have access to internet, search these, examine these, discuss it with your friends. That's another part of the dimension of experiment. Whenever you experiment something, share, not necessarily only in the class. Share it with your friends, share it with anybody. That is how knowledge increases. Okay. Yes. Not necessarily. You don't know what that garbage is. What? Correct. Yes. You are applying maths there. So now you do the following. You take two variables m and n. Write a program which just does m by n. Give different values of m, give different values of n, and see what you get. Do that experiment. I would suggest that, this is a good point that you make, but I would suggest that whenever you have these doubts, did you ask your TA? Ah, very good. So I have to conduct a lecture for the TAs. Good. Henceforth, I will insist that all TAs do these things themselves for once. Okay. But it's a good point that you make. I would still suggest, park it in your mind. Don't give up. And find out by more experimentation and more discussion. Anyway, I must end this class because I promised I will end 5 minutes before. Just two last announcements, important announcements. Tomorrow Saturday, the Hindi lecture which I conduct in the morning will not be conducted in the morning because Professor Narayanan, as I mentioned last time, there is a group of students who were deficient in English and who have joined CS101. Some of them will be having a separate class. So this is a reminder to everybody who has joined that program for the English deficient students. We are all meeting at 2 o'clock in the Kamal Rekhi building opposite this place in room 301. And the additional Hindi explanations, etc., will be conducted in that way. Tomorrow we don't have an extra lecture, but next Saturday we will have an extra lecture for both the batches. Similarly, these handouts, please try out these problems at home before you come to the lab. This time the lab handout will be given to you just before the lab, and there will be an assignment which will not be printed and given. It will appear out of nowhere on the Moodle at precisely 1 hour after start of the time. And within that 1 hour, you will have to solve that problem, write a program and upload that program, because all submissions are automatic. There are no hand submissions. Is that okay? Thank you so much.